Podcast.
Hello and welcome back to another episode of Battlefield Podcast. This is episode 140. I am Ola, aka Chalk One, and alongside me, as always, we have Tim, aka Darkness 429. Hey Tim, how's it going?
Oh, it's good. It's good to be back. It's
been a while since we talked Battlefield.
It's true. It's nice to be back where we belong.
Yes. About a week and a half ago, we talked about Warfighter. We'll probably touch on that a little bit later on, but let me introduce our guest first for this episode, and we have back with us again Daskro. Thanks for joining us again.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me, and I'm glad to be here.
So a couple quick administrative things I want to mention. I don't think I'm going to be putting together a Clip of the Week episode this week because I'm leaving for a few days at the end of the week, so I just won't have time to edit that together, but you can still submit your clips, so that'll still be good. And we're still doing the Movember thing. Tim, what happened to... You're kind of... Yeah, you're working on it. Let's talk about some news, since we haven't talked about any of this in a while.
And now for the latest Battlefield news!
So probably the first thing that we want to talk a little bit about is that exclusive crossbow gameplay trailer that was released for premium members about a week or so, or maybe a week and a half ago. And, you know, it's one of those videos that I don't even know if it made it to YouTube yet, but it's not supposed to, so we're not going to play it for you. But they talk a little bit about the different bolts that are going to be available for the crossbow. There's going to be four different ones, right?
Yep.
And we've got the standard bolt, high explosive bolt, the scan bolt, and the sniper bolt. Which should be interesting. I suppose it's going to give it a little bit more of a variety. I think of this thing similar to the M320 or the M26 or something like that, where you have different versions of them, buckshot, you know, all that stuff. So.
Yeah, it definitely makes it more versatile. For sure. I'm excited to see what the high explosive bolt will do. In my mind, it seems like an anti-vehicle type bolt, and that'll be fun to use out in the battlefield.
Yeah, and that was in the video. It actually looked pretty cool. It is literally like a little grenade on a stick. It looked interesting. I'm still not sure if I'm going to use this thing a whole lot, but I'm not sure if it's going to take over the place of something like that third slot, like the med kit or, you know, I don't know, rocket launcher. I don't know. What do you think, Dustin?
I'm looking forward to all of them, but I think the scan bolts in particular is going to be very interesting to utilize, especially on the smaller game modes where you mainly have perhaps five or six or eight people per side. If you're playing on a map that only has a few lanes, three or four lanes, a good scan bolt, you know, in one area, got a 10-meter radius maybe,
right.
Or is it diameter, one of the two. But you put that there, and if you're really good at watching that mini map, you'll be able to see people flanking you, and that can be huge in terms of being able to react effectively. And so I think it's going to be kind of an interesting thing. I hope the high explosive bolt isn't too overpowered because I'm a vehicle guy and I don't want all these little arrows hitting me and all these little explosions happening. Here's how I hope it turns out to be. In previous Battlefield games, when you were facing a tank and you were not an anti-tank guy, you basically had two options. If you had a C4, you could throw a C4 at him, or you could throw your grenade at him. When you threw your grenade, and if that tank was near your grenade or over your grenade, went off, it did a small amount of damage, perhaps at the most 3 to 5% damage. I think that's fine if the high explosive bolt does that, because it's not enough to get a disable, but it is enough to at least have a little bit punch, and I think I'm fine with that. So I'm looking forward to it. I think it'll be a lot of fun.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing is we will do it. We'll give everybody some of the abilities of other classes. So everybody will have the ability to carry the high explosive bolt against vehicles. Everyone will have a tugs or MAV sort of ability, stationary, but I guess similar to the tugs with the scan bolt. Same with the sniper bolt. So I guess it does sort of balance it out a bit and makes for some interesting combinations, I would imagine. Tim's talking to the chat. Oh, President showed up. That's what it is. So yeah, the Bolt's going to be interesting. I'm looking forward to that in Aftermath. The other thing that has been announced by DICE is the feature of an actually shaking map. In Aftermath, there's actually going to be afterquakes or aftershocks that are going to randomly shake the map, which seems interesting. And it's going to be a server-controlled random timer. So it's not going to be one of those things where you know, oh, you know what, in 2 seconds now I need to stand still because everything's going to go to hell.
Right.
But it'll be interesting. I'm trying to remember any shaking in the single-player campaign. Maybe I just haven't got there yet.
There was some aftershocks in the Iran maps, but nothing to this extent. They do talk about dynamic changes in the map, levels underneath you falling out, walls caving in, things like that. That'll always be different. So it definitely changes the way that you have to play the map. It's not always the same way every time. So that'll be neat to see.
I'm also looking forward to that as well, although admittedly, and people are going to, I may regret saying this, but I haven't played the Battlefield 3 single player yet. And I know that's crazy, but I haven't. I'm not a single player guy. I played the co-op campaigns to get some of the unlocks. There's some shaking in one of them, or at least towards the end before you're boarding the helicopter or something like that. But I haven't played the single player. I haven't played a single player game in a long time. And I sort of have a list of single player games that I want to play, but just haven't had the time for it. Battlefield 3, we wanted them. Medal of Honor Warfighter, the single player, I've heard is actually pretty good. The new Max Payne game, I haven't played that one yet. The Kane Lynch series, I haven't played those. I haven't played single player in a long time. But hopefully this Aftermath Vibrations thing gets kind of cool. It may not be best for competitive play since it's randomized. Yeah. But I think from a pub perspective, it may be a lot of fun.
And I think you're probably not the only one that hasn't touched the single-player campaign. I've played a little bit of it, but it's basically come to the point where I played a little bit, I think, on Saturday, where there was just nobody else online. I was like, okay, well, I guess I'll go play some single. I didn't want to go just into random servers and stuff like that. So it's a good single-player campaign, though.
Yeah, they did a good job for never having a single-player and trying it out. They did a good job.
Yeah. Well, they had a lot to sort of pick up from Bad Company. Both of those games had really good single-player campaigns, I thought. So, speaking of one of those Battlefield games that had no single-player at all, it's Battlefield 1942, and that was released for free on Origin for the PC only in, I guess, for its 10th anniversary. So, it's fully up-to-date. You don't have to do any patching. They say that it can support mods, but they don't support them officially. I think they said that they've tested it with Desert Combat. And what's the other one? Eve something.
Eve of Destruction?
Yes, thank you.
Was that the Vietnam one?
Yeah,
yes.
That's the one. Mm-hmm. One of the more popular ones. So, and you can just grab it off of Origin for the PC. It's a free download. It's in the demo section there. I tried it out the other day on a stream. It works well. It runs really fast, of course. It's quite a bit of a different playstyle. Word of warning, if you kill too many of your teammates by accident, they will kick you. that happened. So
does it come with the expansion packs, or is it just vanilla 1942?
No. It's just the regular vanilla version.
Gotcha.
Build it a little bit, I think. It's the same game. It's also not compatible.
It does have some of the free-to-play maps, though, like Aberdeen and Battle of Britain and Coral Sea. So it's got a lot of those sort of interesting maps that when we played Armored Shield, it was very similar to that kind of map layout where you essentially have all these vehicles playing against each other. You really sort of see where a lot of the Armored Kill maps come from, is from a lot of those old BF942 maps.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, especially if you're looking for large maps. There's some pretty large maps in Battlefield 1942, definitely. And for whatever method they use to make this compatible with Origin means that it's no longer compatible with the original version of 1942. You can have both of them installed, though. I have both of them installed at the same time. So. And, you know, you can run your own server. You can run your own dedicated server. It's pretty easy. If you've never checked it out before and you started, there's a lot of people in Battlefield 3 that started with Bad Company 2 and stuff. You should go back and just get a feel for where this whole franchise started. It's worthwhile. And then they also released a 150 megabyte digital concept artwork package that you can download from the catalog as well. So,
pretty.
Lots of good drawings and stuff. Now, so there was this rumor about Battlefield 4 that I didn't know if we were going to talk about it at first, but then people asked me, are we going to talk about it on Twitter and stuff like that? It's like, well, we might as well mention it briefly. It did happen. It did make some of the... some of the news I get. Supposedly, this information was leaked by EA China, which didn't even know that that existed.
I didn't know EA had an office in China.
No. I think the funniest thing about this is, so this was an original post in Chinese that was then translated both by Google Translate and by somebody who actually speaks Chinese, and it's basically just a list of bullet points. I guess we can look at these. My first impression of these were, well, if I was going to speculate, I got a cat trying to break in, I think. if I was going to speculate on what Battlefield 4 was going to be like, this is what I would write down,
yeah,
more or less.
Yeah.
So you guys discuss while I go let the cat in.
Sure.
there's a lot of things in these supposed rumors that I think... we'd like to see. I don't know how much I agree with the idea that it would be both compatible with the current generation of consoles, PS3 and Xbox 360, but also the next generation of consoles, which they describe as PS4 and Xbox 720. I think that may be a bit too much to ask for a set of developers to create both same for the next generation consoles and previous generation consoles. Also, things like goofy things like can deploy female soldiers. And I understand the whole diversity thing, but the thing is that I think that are they trying to prove something? I mean, even the U.S. military today doesn't, you know, have an official. I mean, its official policy is not to allow female soldiers on the front lines, even though that a lot of them do frontline roles. So I don't know. Some of those comments don't make much sense. So I don't know. What about you? What do you think, Tim?
I think there was like you said, there were just odd things about this this post. Things talking about the Frostbite 2 engine, how it was only utilizing 30-40% of the engine itself, and that they were going to use 80% of its overall power in the next game. There are things that they've talked about. Go ahead.
One other thing that I thought was kind of interesting is that if you read the EA Games most recent annual report, they actually do talk about how they are investing a significant amount of their R&D into the next generation consoles. And maybe this is alluding to it, maybe it's not. If we look at how the Frostbite 2 engine is now being utilized across multiple EA titles, perhaps they are revamping it for a next-gen console so that they can have that platform solidified. So when they do subsequent titles, the incremental costs will be, you know, much lower relative to new game development.
Yeah, I think the points about the next-generation consoles, that's probably the biggest thing for me, is that we know very little, if anything, about next-generation consoles, so it would be very odd if, you know, this would be happening there, especially if it's also on current-gen consoles and on the PC. The other ones are more like wish list items, Commander System.
Right.
Video playback and sharing. We're seeing that now with Origin. That's one thing, actually, I didn't add to the list of things that we should talk about briefly, because we're all doing video stuff on the side, is that Origin for PC is going to support integrated streaming to Twitch, just like we're doing now, straight from the game. And it would be integrated right into Origin in an upcoming release. So, again, those are things that you can just, you know, speculate with reasonable certainty that that's going to be included in future games, whether it's Battlefield 4, Bad Company 3, whatever comes out of EA next, that's going to be on the PC and Origin and supporting Battlelog. So it's not a lot of, ooh, didn't think of that.
Right.
No.
So.
I definitely think that you're right. This is just a bunch of wish list items and speculations there. I don't think in any way does this hold any type of, there's no actual like strength behind what this is saying. I really don't think that we're going to see these as actual points to Battlefield 4.
And I, you know, and one other thing that kind of irks me is that the three factions, you got Russia, U.S., and China. I think when you look at how Hollywood and the gaming entertainment industry has recently dealt with the China question, they have usually backed off of it in the sense that they don't want to portray China as this antagonist. And I think there's some big reservations on EA's front, given that if you look at EA's most successful games outside of casual gaming and first-person shooters, it's the sports games. It's FIFA. And they want to make FIFA as accessible as possible. And I don't see them risking a potential alienation of that Chinese demographic.
Sure.
And or worse yet, the PRC says, hey, we're not going to allow you to sell FIFA in China at all.
Right.
I don't think they'll risk that. I don't think they will. That's an emerging market that they are salivating over.
A lot of this sounds like they took BF2 points and threw it in with BF4 because we had Chinese soldiers in Battlefield 2.
Yes.
So it's funny things like that. I was reading through. It's like the commander system. Yeah. It's just BF2 revamped for modern day.
Yeah, and it's a lot of those things that people always say that they want, right? When you hear people talking, especially Battlefield 2 veterans, they want the commander system, they want squad VoIP, bigger squads, more squads. Everybody, of course, wants more out of the game. So, yeah, it's going to use more of the Frostbite 2 engine. I could have told you that. The other thing that's interesting as well is that there's supposedly, in this rumor, it says that the... I guess the next-gen consoles are going to support 64-player maps. But again, that's just speculation about the power of what those new console systems may have. We've already got that on the PC, so that's not a surprise there. So.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, take that with a large grain of salt, probably a shaker of salt. And so what we're going to do in a second here, we're going to talk a little bit about the business of Battlefield and some of the... the way that things work financially and how things have worked and what EA has tried, and we'll see what we can come up with.
Battlefield Podcast Spotlight of the Week.
So Dasko, I know you'd brought this up before. This was in some way your idea, talking a little bit about the business behind Battlefield. What do you think is most interesting about it? I mean, Battlefield, obviously, for EA, is a big, big franchise. I guess outside of all their sports franchises, those are always huge. But it's their big first-person shooter. And over the years, they've tried a lot of different things, different models. We've had free games, Battlefield Heroes, and free-to-play Battlefield, play for free. Of course, the traditional model where you just pay your $60 for the game and that's it. But I think over the years, it's always cost EA a lot of money to maintain games and support them and pay for servers and stuff like that. So with Battlefield Premium, they kind of appear to want to try to figure out this way. I guess what I'm saying is ideally they'd love to charge you $15 a month to play Battlefield 3 because for them financially, that would make the most sense. I don't think we'd be very happy with it, but...
No, I think that the Battlefield series represents a franchise that has gone through a number of different attempts at figuring out what is not only the best for the bottom line financially for these publicly traded companies, but also the best experience for the gaming community that supports it, that buys the games. remember the Battlefield started 10 years ago plus as a traditional PC game, distributed from an EB Games or from a GameStop or whatever it may be. And you went in, you paid your $50-$60, you got the physical copy of the game, you played it, and that was the end of it. But this was very much the same model that Activision used in the Call of Duty series and what EA used in Medal of Honor. But as things had changed, both in terms of the increasing growth of the PC market, but really the exponential growth of the console market, we've seen a shift in emphasis towards that console game type. Still the same distribution channels in terms of going to a box store, getting your game, and having at it. But as the internet has evolved and more of these console systems became internet connected, new offerings have now taken place. DLCs, premium type services like Battlefield Premium or Call of Duty Elite. And with this, new revenue opportunities and with varying degrees of margins associated with each of these, which is to say of how profitable each of these types of endeavors are. Battlefield Premium is sort of an interesting concept, I think, because as a service, you're essentially buying, five, six expansion packs? I forget the exact number. Mm-hmm. And when you buy those expansion packs, you're putting down a bunch of cash on the table. Right. And EA gets to hold on to that cash and promise you releases in a timely fashion and different types of exclusive content and things like that. How did it work previous to that? In previous business models, most of these games used an expansion concept where you would either have a standalone expansion or alternatively you would have these incremental expansions, which we now kind of think of DLCs as sort of a modern day version of that, where you go to the game store, you pick up the expansion, you got to have the full game, you got to have your expansion pack CD or disc, and you incrementally install it up, and then you can play that expansion, be it the single player or be it a multiplayer experience. I think back in the original Half-Life, when you had things like opposing forces as well, there you go.
Special forces. Sorry, I know you can't see it because you're not looking at that camera, but I'm just to your point, I have in my shelf here Battlefield 2 Special Forces expansion pack, which is probably $30 or something, and you had to go into the store, look at this ginormous box that all it's got inside is
two discs or something like that.
CDs. So, Yeah.
So, and really what that does is what does that company do? Be it Battlefield or EA with Battlefield, DICE Battlefield, or Valve with the Half-Life expansions. I was thinking of Blue Shift and Posing Fronts, things like that. What's their decision-making process? Well, they have to decide that they have an opportunity to make an expansion. They know it's going to cost so much more money to make an expansion. They already have the engine. They already have all the coders. They already have all the textures done. They just have to build the story, build up the maps, things like that. And then they have to distribute it and advertise for it and then sell it, hopefully to make some money back. And traditionally, that's sort of been the model for both a lot of DLCs and for these sort of traditional expansion packs we've seen in years past. And there's certain risks associated with that, in the sense that you do not know how many people that installed base of the original number of people who bought the game originally will actually buy that expansion or DLC. And you may have an expectation that total, 5 million people that buy it, only maybe 20%, a million of them will buy that expansion. And you may make a whole lot more money, much more profit off that expansion relative to, for instance, the making that AAA title in the first place. But as they build out successive iterations, the DLCs or expansion packs, less and less people buy the game. And oh, maybe you can speak to this. When you bought that Battlefield 2 expansion you just showed, relative to how many people were playing regular Battlefield, how many people were playing it on multiplayer?
Well, it was certainly less. It seemed like the more and more expansions came out, the smaller the player base grew. So
Right. You'd
have more people playing, and then Tim, we played at the same time. So There's more people playing BF2. Special Forces, I think, sold pretty well. It was fairly common. But then they had a couple booster packs, which EA came up with that concept, which really would be considered DLC because it's not a full expansion pack. This is like a small one, so they called it a booster pack. Mm-hmm. There was Euro Forces and Armored.
It was Armored Kill.
Armored Fury.
There you go. Yes. Armored Kill's one we have now.
Yeah. And those two were not very much used. Euro Forces especially. It wasn't very good, to be honest.
I only had the Armored Fury one. I never got Euro Forces. Yeah. And then eventually they just rolled it into one big pack and gave it out for free.
I remember that. That was so goofy that they did that. But it was years after.
Because originally what they did is they put it into a Battlefield 2 premium pack, and it was Battlefield 2 Special Forces, and then the two booster packs, and then eventually, they right around the time that Bad Company had hit, they had rolled out the large patch that had everything inside of it.
Oh, so, just now that you mentioned patching, that was the other thing that was always a big disaster at those times, was you had to patch all these stupid expansion packs too. So the last time I installed Battlefield 2 from the discs, I installed Battlefield 2, patched that to the latest version, Special Forces, patched that to the latest version, then you had to patch Battlefield 2 again because somewhere along the way Special Forces screwed up the latest version of that. You know, you had to just keep going back and back and forth. But there was
some type of sequential order that you had to patch it. Yes. It wasn't just one patch. Yeah. You had to do.
You could do
patch
it wrong.
1.26 and then patch to 1.28. So it was things like that. That's very finicky.
Welcome to PC gaming.
It was very finicky, and further, from a console perspective, a lot of the expansion pack concepts don't work nearly as well. This idea that you buy the game on Xbox, then you get an expansion pack, you got to swap all these discs back and forth.
Right.
And that may be a bit off-putting. And I imagine that they probably did try it on a number of titles, but found that it wasn't nearly as attractive compared to other alternatives. And as internet-enabled console gaming became more in vogue, the DLCs and the small amount of content that they provided, you know, seemed like a good good option relative to the alternative.
Yeah, and the thing that back in those days, you know, one of the other points of having all this stuff on a CD was that if you were downloading a gigabyte DLC, it would probably take you 20 hours, maybe a day and a half, depending on your internet connection speed. You know, you didn't really have that now, where you download Battlefield 3, it's like 11 gigs or something like that, and you just, okay, I'll just do that. No big deal. So,
and you actually
really
hit upon
distribution model.
I actually do want to talk about the distribution model later. So let's not forget about that. But still talking about premium though. What I think is sort of interesting about premium is that sort of like, you know, somewhat similar to the season passes that Black Ops 2 is doing. What the premium package does from a business perspective, and this is not, I want to separate this in terms of describing a business perspective versus a fan base perspective. From a business perspective, even though that you may not be able to sell as many units of that given pass, in this case BF3 Premium, relative to just putting out an expansion pack, the fact that you can sell these things for a large amount of money, and you can essentially guarantee a certain amount of revenue, albeit deferred revenue, that you will collect over time as you release subsequent DLCs and subsequent expansion packs, which in this case we're talking about the Close Quarters, the Armored Kill, Aftermath, Endgame. It actually puts a whole lot more stability into the development cycle of the games themselves, in the sense that if you have, and what's that? BF3 Premium sold 2.1 million units in the last 9 months, approximately. That translates into, at $50 a pop, maybe about $100 million worth of revenue. Now, for perspective, Battlefield 3 as a game has sold roughly 17 million copies, or to put it another way, about $540 million worth of revenue worldwide across all platforms. Now, this is actually being analysts' expectations. The expectation was that by the end of the calendar year of 2012, which is just another 2 months, they'd sell 18 million. And so they only got to sell a million more copies within the next, 3 months, because that 17 million number came from there into their second quarter 2013, which was September 30th of 2012. So really, they're on track to beat their expectations from a financial perspective of selling Battlefield 3. But from a premium perspective, that additional 100 million that they put out, it guarantees them the development cycle to continue putting out all of those expansion packs. And they don't have to pose the question every quarter. Well, we only sold, make it up numbers here, a million copies of Bat to Karkin. Do we want to spend another $20 million to invest in making a Close Quarters expansion pack or an Aftermath expansion pack? Right. And if you look at how a lot of these DLC sell across the gaming market, they sell less and less and less each time. Just like when you were playing Battlefield 2 Euroforce, there were less and less people playing it. Mm-hmm. In subsequent expansions. And so it actually creates a bit of risk mitigation in the process, because it means that you can have on staff the same people making all subsequent DLCs. Yeah. And on top of that, you can provide that sort of overhead support layer of creating subsequent patches and providing that sort of community support that you otherwise would have to sort of make that decision of, well, we haven't sold a game in a while. We haven't actually generated that much cash in a while from this title. Do I really want to pay another, five people who are software developers to continue supporting this game when I could put them on another title in which that title is actually going to make money off, for us, that kind of thing?
People always cynically say that Battlefield Premium was just EA's ways of getting you money right off the bat at the beginning. It's like, yes. That's precisely what you're just demonstrating there. The point is, they get the money up front so that they don't have that uncertainty of, trying to figure out whether people will still want to buy Endgame from now. They've already bought it, those 2 million people have anyways.
And really, with a lot of these companies that are large publicly traded companies, they are going to be building a business case as to decide whether or not they should invest in a new title or a new expansion. And what they're going to do is not just look at how much profit they can make off of a given successive title. They're actually going to look at the time value of money, which is to say that they're going to look at how much capital they have to invest in the people, in the hardware, and the licenses, and the servers, and things like that, and say, okay, I have to invest a certain amount of money up front, and then eventually, through a successive number of sales, I will make that money back and a return, and it will, and hopefully that return will be better than if I just took that same amount of money and just invested it into the stock market or into the bond market or what have you. And that series of questions is actually based on cash flow. It's not based off of revenue. And cash flow is really important to understand, because with Battlefield 3 Premium and other passes like it, you get all the cash all up front, and that cash buys certainty. It allows you to very comfortably make that decision of, well, I don't care, and this is more the more cynical aspect of it, I don't care if Aftermath or Endgame are really shitty titles. I don't care. I got my money, and I don't have to worry about whether successive titles are going to be successful or not, because they've already bought the kit and caboodle. And that's right. A more cynical look at it, because EA could just as easily say, well, screw off, Battlefield community. I already got my money. I'm out of here. They could just as easily do that. But on the flip side, if they feel burnt by the reception of Armored Kill, and I'll tell you, there were a lot of Battlefield 3 players that weren't a big fan of Armored Kill.
Yeah.
And if they would have read reviews prior to, let's just pretend there wasn't Battlefield 3 Premium, and most people were just buying them on a case-by-case basis, they probably wouldn't have sold many copies of Armored Kill, because it was very niche or specialized expansion pack just for those players like me that like playing armor. And so there is some give and take in that in terms of whether they want to make those decisions in sort of iteratively as all these various expansions come out, or all at once. And from a pure business perspective, the BF3 Premium concept makes a whole lot more sense. But clearly, there's sort of some community or fan base aspects. And what do you guys think about the fan base aspects about it?
What do you think, Tim?
Sorry, ask the question. I was reading the chat.
What was your reaction to it when Battlefield 3 came out? This makes sense from a business perspective, but what, as a someone who likes playing Battlefield, what were your thoughts on it?
I was honestly excited to see something that wasn't Bad Company, something that I felt was going to be in a continuation of Battlefield 2. I really enjoyed Battlefield 2. I enjoyed the different style that we saw, not from, you know, it wasn't just your normal average everyday FPS. So I was excited. I was a little disappointed, but you know, as a diehard Battlefield fan, I was excited overall to get my hands on it.
Well, and when Premium came out, I think one of the things that probably pulled in a few people, including myself, is that if you just did the math and you said to yourself, you know what, I'm going to buy these expansion packs regardless, and if I buy all, let's say, four of them together for $15 each, that's $60. Premium's going to cost me $50.
Mm-hmm.
I'll save $10. So, you know, that's one of the reasons. The other thing was is that I'll pay for it now. I don't have to worry about it. I know I'm going to get another expansion in December. I'm going to get another one next March. And I won't have to worry about scrounging together another $15 here or there. It's already
right.
All done.
When I bought Premium, my way of justifying the purchase was, this will help increase the longevity of the game. This will make me want to play the game that I put money into, my investment. And yes, I'm putting another $50 into it, but because I enjoy playing it, I enjoy playing it with friends that I have that I've, you know, built relationships through Battlefield itself, this will help continue the fun that I find in playing the game.
It's almost that little bit of guilt factor, too, when Aftermath and Endgame come out. It's like, well, I got to try it. I've paid for it.
Right.
I'm going to have to give it a chance, at least.
And I think that for the diehard Battlefield fans, it really is sort of a great buy. And I think that both of you spoke to this, in that, and this is something that I personally agree with quite substantially, it forces DICE to support the game for more than just 6 or 7 months. And
right.
One of the things that a lot of people who didn't play the Battlefield games before Bad Company 2 don't fully appreciate was that DICE was very hit or miss in terms of the patching.
That's putting it mildly, yeah.
Yeah. And there were some Battlefield games prior to BC2 that were actually very quick with patches, and there were some that were really quite horrendous. Or worse yet, had the kind of experience that both of you described in terms of this sort of having the right sequence of patches, or as everything messes up and you got to reinstall the game from scratch. I remember reinstalling Battlefield 1942 hundreds of times over the course of, you know, the 3 or 4 years I played it. It was because of all the patch and stuff. But the thing about Bad Company 2 was that Bad Company 2 as a game was actually pretty horrendous in terms of its patching. And I don't know if that was because of the fact that it was mostly console based, or because that the engine had issues with subsequent patches, but there were huge problems with both revives and with really imbalanced guns. And it took DICE and EA 4 or 5 months before they got a real patch to solve the issue down. And they did they had real problems with that. And they were really putting it around when either the BF or Bad Company 2 Vietnam expansion came out, or sometime in between, but it wasn't that often. And I am really, really heartened by Battlefield 3 because they actually patch it pretty regularly. I mean, they're patching it nearly almost a month, every month and a half for the most part. Mm-hmm. And that in part has to do with the updates of the new expansions as they come out. But I think it's a good thing that they are patching it as much as they are, because it means that they are still committed to working with the community and figuring out things that are problematic and what have you. You know, on the flip side, though, there's a lot of commentators who are more casual gamers and are more a la carte in terms of the games that they play. And they do bring up some good arguments as to the Battlefield 3 premium issue. One, they maybe only want to pay for one DLC, and they feel like they're getting cheapskated when they don't have the ability to level up as fast as others because of double XP weekends or premium only or other exclusive content. Now, I think that as time has unfolded, a lot of the Battlefield 3 premium exclusive content has been, to me, the equivalent of DVD extras. They're not something that a casual person is really going to they're not going to miss anything if they don't have it. I mean, it's like at work, I have a coworker of mine who we both saw the movie Prometheus in theaters. We both enjoyed it. But he's a more casual moviegoer. He's not a Ridley Scott fan. He's not an Aliens franchise fan, whereas I am. And so when the Prometheus Blu-ray came out, I only got it and watched Prometheus. I watched it with the Ridley Scott commentary. I watched 4 hours worth of DVD making of extras nonsense. I probably put in 15 hours worth of time watching all those different iterations because I'm a big, you know, fan of that series. For diehard Battlefield fans, premium makes sense, and the extras do provide a little bit more insight, a little more interest in that respect. Right. But for the casual people, maybe not so much, because admittedly, a lot of those casual people, they may play the first DLC, they may play the Karkin expansion, they may even play Close Quarters. But by the time you get to Armored Kill or get to Endgame or Aftermath, a lot of them may have left already. But that's what happens. Everyone knows that in subsequent expansions, less and less of a fan base is there because there's always something else to play.
Yeah, and it also, I think it gave DICE a bit of the ability to create these DLCs that are a little more specialized. Like you have Close Quarters, which was very specialized into close quarter infantry fighting. Armored Kill, like you said, large maps and stuff. Pretty polarizing. A lot of people hated one or the other. And you probably wouldn't have gotten those people to buy both of them. You probably get some people to buy one, some people to buy the other. But with this, you know, they're insured to at least give it a try, and it's there already. So did you want to talk a little bit about the way that distribution's changed?
Yeah.
And how the consoles have had a pretty significant impact on that, I think. And I've noticed this myself, because I went out, I dusted off the Xbox 360 last week, brought it up here, hooked it up, and I'm like, okay, now let's go buy a game. And one of the benefits that I've had with PC gaming and Origin, it's become so easy, almost too easy. You just go in there, you're like, oh, I want that. Buy, you know, pay for it, download it, boom, you're ready to go. You don't even have to get up from your chair. Now, there's downsides to that, of course, because, as I mentioned earlier, I'm going to go trade in a game later. I can't do that with a digital PC game.
Right.
But certainly a lot has changed. And as we were talking about those booster packs for Battlefield 2, I think that was before Steam, or maybe right at the very beginning of Steam.
It was,
and EA, was it before?
It was it was right around the time when the idea of digital downloads had started becoming the thing to do. I remember having a conversation with somebody, and it was all about, like, how am I not going to have something physical that I can hold in my hand?
Yes.
And you know, and spend a half an hour trying to install on my computer. Like, what is this? And the more and more I think about it, the more and more I was like, wow, I was completely ignorant to this. I should have thought about it more and how convenient it is to just download. But like we had talked about before, internet speeds were atrocious. You know, to have, you know, 3 to 5 megabyte downloads was something you never even thought of back in the day. Now, you know, downloading Battlefield 3, a game that's 16 gigabytes, is like, oh, you know, I'll spend, you know, 30 to 45 minutes downloading and I'll play. It's very interesting to think about the idea of just going on to Steam or onto Origin and just clicking and buying a game and downloading it.
Well, you mentioned that. It's funny. People held on to wanting to have that physical game box because there was a level of distrust, like there still is with EA anyways, but I think less so with digital downloads now. People were like, well, if I download this and I don't remember my password, or you just screw it up and take it away from me, I'd rather have the box. I can put it in my shelf and I know where it is. and I think it was called EA Downloader back then.
It was a very clunky piece of crap.
Oh, it was terrible. It was terrible. I remember that. I mean, Tim, you bring up a really good point, because I remember going to LAN parties 10, 12 years ago. And if you went to a LAN party 10, 12 years ago, you're going to know exactly what I'm about to talk about. At LAN parties back then, people were pirating games like crazy. And it's partially still an issue on PC, and it's a big issue. But I remember partying Tribes, and just because we just wanted to all play on LAN and do LAN play, and we would just go into each other's Windows file explorers and go to the network sharing and just copy paste the entire directory of the whole thing, and it would in a 100 megabit connection, it didn't take that long, and then you're good to go. And so for me, I was a bit more receptive to the idea of having digital downloads than maybe a lot of people were, but maybe it was because of my unique experience there. But what's kind of interesting, though, about the digital download phenomenon is that from a business perspective, a lot of these companies are salivating over it. They're loving it. And here's why. And EA actually talked about this in one of their recent quarterly calls, where they talked about how that they see a 15% to 20% increase in their gross profit, which is how much they sell the game for minus how much the game costs them. They see a 20% increase in that gross profit when they sell digitally versus when they sell through retail. And that's because they're cutting out the middleman. Even though there's a server, and even though that there's you got to buy bandwidth and things like that, they're increasing the margins by a huge degree, and something that can't be scoffed at. Because let me kind of put it in a different perspective. If they were to sell Battlefield 3 through an all digital distribution channel, they probably could have made another $150 to $200 million. Or to put it another way, it would have been the equivalent of selling another 2 to 3 million copies, that kind of thing. That's a pretty significant aspect to it. And there's actually even a better case to be made for online digital services, DLCs and subscriptions and things like that. Premium actually fits into that subscription-based concept, where it's either a DLC or a series of DLCs or just a service. So for EA Games, it's the new Star Wars MMO. For Activision Blizzard, it's World of Warcraft. And even though that they got to hire all these GMs and you got to have all these servers and things like that, it's not a lot of money. And so they're making money
cheaper every year too.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. It is just, they make money hands over fists relative to traditional titles, especially on the console end. Because here's the thing, the console end is all going to a brick and mortar store and buying a physical disc. And And with the exception of the DLCs that are digital only download kind of stuff, the margin the console ones are making is much less compared to the digital PC or just the subscription-based services more generally. Now, this is completely offset by the fact that if you look at how much money EA or Activision makes off the PC market, it equals to essentially maybe the PlayStation 3 market as a standalone. You take PS3, you take the Nintendo Wii, you take Xbox 360, and it's a much larger market by volume. And as such, even though you have smaller margins, that's okay, because it's so much bigger that you still make a lot of money off of it, a lot of earnings. So it's something to really think about as the next generation consoles come out, the Xbox 720s, the PS4s, will they have the hard drive capacity to do the DLC model? Will the traditional brick and mortar stores, the Best Buys, the GameStops, EB Games, what have you, will they eventually kind of find themselves sort of out of the race when they're no longer a viable distributor relative to the direct download model? It's a very interesting question to think about, and while a lot of us in the PC end have already experienced a sort of revolution in digital downloads, where I, for instance, haven't bought a physical PC game at a brick and mortar store probably in 5-6 years, perhaps.
Well, they're not there anymore either. If you go to a GameStop or EB Games and you've got Xbox 360, PS3, and Wii games, and that's it. There's hardly ever, there's a very small selection of PC games, if there's any. And, you know, the other thing that you mentioned about those stores going away, I think if the publishers had the way, they'd be perfectly fine with that, because not only are their margins greater online, you, like I said earlier, you cannot trade your digital copy of a game.
Right.
You know, they always lose money on that when people trade in their games on consoles, even though they're trying to get around with that with these online passes and stuff, so at least that people have to spend another $10 or so to get the game back online.
And you actually hit upon a side topic real quick, I'll let you go, Tim, in just a second. The thing is about the GameStop CB Games, when you look at their financial statements from a business perspective, they make most of their money, their earnings, their profit off the used game market, because you bring in a game, you get some in-store credit, you get to, you know, buy a game. They make money hands over fist on that. And if that digital distribution model takes hold in the console market, these companies are done. And it's something that they should sort of figure out ways to diversify themselves, which maybe it means specializing in peripherals or something else around those lines. Anyway, I just wanted to mention that in passing. Tim, you wanted to say something?
Oh, the only thing I wanted to say was that the way that we're going with the video game industry is almost the exact same shift that we saw a few years ago with the music industry. You know, how many music record stores do you see nowadays that, you know, the CD sales are, you know, not as very low as in comparison to, you know, the iTunes store sales. So I definitely agree with you in saying that I feel like in the next few years, I think EB or, you know, GameStop, even like, you know, things like the Walmart game section and whatnot, those will be gone.
Well, and the PC prices are so enticing. Some of the promotions they can come up with on Origin are pretty incredible. I was looking a few days ago. I think they had a Veteran Day sale for Battlefield 3 for $20. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I looked at my local stores for the consoles. They're still charging $59.99.
Hmm.
So
I think what's really indicative about this is I frequent Reddit.com, and there was a recent front page post, and I think the topic was centered around the lines of, tell me easy tips in which I can save money. And one of the highest upvoted comments of this was, uninstall Steam, because the Steam sales always make you want to buy things. And it was sort of, you know, said tongue-in-cheek, but the kind of offerings that both Steam and Origin can provide to sort of spur up this initial interest in buying something is significant, and there's no need for massive advertising or anything around those lines. They just offer a deal, and that little spur can create a lot of interest in games that otherwise may not have sold that much, you know, in the previous year, perhaps. It really is quite fascinating in that respect.
Yeah, Bad Company 2 for PC was on sale at that same time. It was $9.99. You know, a lot of people will still consider that and say, you know what, yeah, I'll pick that up. $10, that's not much, and I'll check it out. I've always wanted to try it, right? You're not going to see anybody go down to your local GameStop and ask for Bad Company 2 and pay $30 for it. That just doesn't happen. So it's definitely all those little $10 games, not only do they burn holes into your pocket over the long run, but they certainly help out the publishers as well. Yeah. So do you want to talk a little bit about the earnings reports?
Oh, yeah. So both Activision and EA Games have both put up their most recent quarter earnings report. What's very fascinating is that Activision said, hey, things are going really well for us, mostly on the Blizzard end. And again, what is an earnings report? Well, a publicly traded company puts out four earnings reports a year, one for each quarter, four quarters. And it basically states how much money they've made, what their balance sheet is in terms of their cash and assets and assets, liabilities, and stockholders' equity. It has, you know, how their cash flows are doing. It has a bunch of different financials that to the Wall Street folks and people that own the shares of that stock, they want to know information about how the company's doing. So Activision came out recently with theirs, and they said that they're beating their expectation, which is good. It means that they beat the forecast that they had put out previously. And in this case, it's because of the successes of the Blizzard games, the Diablo 3s, and the most recent World of Warcraft expansion, the Pandera game with the pandas, and how it's great, and how they expect in the next quarter it's going to be great as well because of Black Ops 2 coming out. And you can actually sort of see how well it's going to be doing because they are actually – so when they make the sales, they are taking pre-orders from all these distributors and things like that, and you can sort of see these pre-orders start to rack up in some of their deferred net revenues, which is to say – these are revenues that they have taken the cash, but they haven't actually delivered the product yet because it's been released yet, in this case, Black Ops 2, and other premium-like services. So this is starting to ratchet up, and that, to me, is indicative of that they expect it to be successful. Now, EA has put out theirs recently as well, September 30th of this year, and they're already saying, and take in mind, I don't think Medal of Honor came out by September 30th. I forget. When did it come out? I forget. October something?
Yeah.
Help me out, guys.
The second weekend of October.
Yes, second weekend of October. And the thing is that they were already saying in their quarterly report, which didn't cover October, it was just the end of September, they said the pre-orders were so low for a Medal of Honor that they actually expect a loss for the next quarter, which is really not good. It means that they're expecting less sales of this flagship title relative to what they expected. And we can sort of see the reaction to this when what was it? Within a week of Medal of Honor coming out, they were already offering discounts for it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I bought my Medal of Honor game for $30.
Yeah,
that was it. And that means that they're struggling. That there are people. They realize that there's not enough people that are going to buy the game at that $60 price point, and so they need to bring that price point down to try to at least spur a little bit of interest in it. But that also is indicative of the fact that they are going to be in trouble for the next quarter at minimum. They may even have to take to write it off, which is never good, but something that they may have to end up doing. So even though that the new Aftermath expansion is coming out in the same quarter and they'll be able to log some more revenue with that, it's not going to be a good position. And again, this is logging revenue, which is different than collecting money or cash. And that's important to differentiate because cash is important. EA Games is a very interesting company because they have made a ton of acquisitions over the last 3 or 4 years, mostly in the casual gaming market. Like PlaySoft and Playgo, something like that. I forget all the companies. But they have spent hundreds of millions of dollars out of all the casual game market because they actually believe the casual game market is going to be bigger than both the PC market and the console market. They believe that. Well, that's why they're investing all this money into it.
There's an EA mobile game that I play. It's on the iPad. It's a Simpsons something or other. I forgot what it's called exactly. But it's all about those in-game purchases, right, which you have to be real careful with. But they have options in there to spend $100 on in-game currency. Wow. Like, I could not spend – I don't know if there's anything on Origin to purchase that's a $100 price tag. But on a mobile device, on an iPad especially, for some reason, that's in there. And I'm sure somebody must have purchased that, right? Yeah. So,
you know, it was – when microtransactions first started coming out, I thought that was the craziest thing ever. To actually spend real money other than what you've already, you know, put on the game, was odd. But more and more companies are starting to integrate that into their games. A lot of the free-to-play games are doing it more and more. Of course, you would think that they would want to get some type of payment back for all the time and development they put into the games, but it's definitely becoming the way of life for these small microtransactions that you know for add-ons and what have you.
And what do you guys think of microtransactions? Be it, are you okay with microtransactions if they're just niceties like you can put a new color on your gun or you can. You can braid your hair, or you can play Barbie doll, or what about microtransactions that actually have a material impact in the game? Like it's basically a play to win model. What do you guys think of those two concepts?
I think it depends on how hardcore of a gamer you are. Someone put in the chat Planet Side 2. There's a lot of Planet Side players that want the edge up on the game. And if you want, you know, a special weapon that does, you know, so much more, you know, critical damage than other weapons, you're going to want to buy that weapon. You're going to want to have that edge on top of everyone else. So I feel like it comes down to how much you want to invest into the game, you know, how competitive you are. I think for casual players, I think it doesn't fit their playing type. I know, like, for me, games like Guild Wars, and other games, some free to play games, I don't think I'd ever, you know, spend money on them because I really don't care enough. But that's just me.
That's funny. I was going to answer your question by saying that I'm not a big fan of play to win. I don't mind if someone wants to spend money to turn their gun purple, which was free in Medal of Honor Warfighter, by the way. But you know, I'm okay with that. And I was just going to say I'm not real happy when people spend money and buy something that will beat me every time. You know, if you can buy a gun that's going to beat me every time and you pay $3 for that, then I don't think I'd be very happy about that. But it's also a change in culture. And as I say that, when you mentioned Guild Wars 2, I was like, you know what, I bought some mini pets in that game, which are completely useless, and I still spent money on it. So I think at first, I'm not a big fan of the idea. But the thing about microtransaction is they're micro, so they're not very large, right? So if it's a dollar here or a dollar there, usually the initial disgust for doing that goes away when you're just like, oh, screw it, I'll just pay the $3 and be on an even playing field. But in general, right, I think the overall opinion of play to win is certainly much lower and not as accepted as just you know, buying cosmetic enhancements, because that's fairly common nowadays.
Yes. No, I think that you're right. But at the same time, you know, I've actually had experiences in my gaming past where I've played pay-to-win games, and I've actually spent money on doing it. And for traditional sort of AAA title competitive games, like I usually play, I'm vehemently against it. But I remember playing some free-to-play games years back. There was a Korean golf game where you had sort of these anime characters, and you had different types of special power golf balls and clubs and stuff like that. And it was basically a crazy golf game. And you could spend the equivalent of $5 and get so many tokens that you could use to do special effects. And me and my gaming teammates would play this sort of in tongue in cheek and harass people and things like that in this game. But having these special abilities actually made the griefing so much more fun and so much more interesting. I forgot what the game was called now, but it was really ridiculous. But even for games like League of Legends, I mean, there are microtransactions in that one as well, albeit the pay to win isn't nearly as significant. But it's still there. The microtransactions are still there nonetheless.
Right,
and there's also There's pay to win, and then there's these things where someone pointed this out in the chat where it's not clearly a pay to win. It's usually got something to do with having to spend less time to accomplish the same thing. You know, Battlefield 3's even done that in a way, not quite as micro, but you can buy booster packs where you unlock certain things if you pay $10 or something like that. You get those things unlocked off the bat instead of having to get whatever, 1,000 kills in the tank or whatever it may be. You know, you got a lot of those games on mobile devices where if you pay this 99 cent to speed up this process, or you could just wait 36 hours and it's going to happen on its own. So it's not really pay to win because it's not a competitive game. It's all a matter of what's your time worth, I guess.
That is an interesting comment. I actually have some pretty strong opinions on the idea of having to spend time or effort or grinding, if you will, to get certain things in the game that otherwise you should be able to get access to. I'm actually not going to bring that aspect of it up, but I think it's a very valid comment because in previous games, especially in the MMO world, there are people that will spend a lot of money to get a leveled up character because they don't have the time for it. And I'll tell you, as someone, if I look back how much time I had available to gaming 10 years ago compared to now, I would have no problem spending what my 10-year younger self would think is an absurd amount of money to get leveled up quickly, because I don't have the time to do it anymore. And right. I still want to experience a certain aspect of the game. And some people may scoff that and say, Dash, what that is completely against what the game's all about. But you know what? I got more things on my plate now than I did in my past. And I can't dedicate the time to it, unfortunately.
And I think that's actually part of the, I guess, the positive side of this, is that it does level the playing field a little bit, where somebody who can't spend 18 hours a day playing a game can still get the same enjoyment out of it or be on a competitive level as somebody else who can't. When those booster options for Battlefield 3 came out, there was a lot of crying out, oh, now someone can just buy what I had to work for. It's like, okay, but so that's why they're paying money for it. It's not given to them for free. So I don't know. It's that balance. And I think as most of us are getting older, we're all getting older, the people that are more willing to spend money on saving time in games, that market keeps growing. It's not a coincidence that all these microtransaction things have come up now, because as people have less time to play, maybe more disposable income, you know, and
I think one can only look at,
want to do that.
I mean, one can only look at the casual market and how it is growing so much faster than the console and PC market, and how microtransactions are becoming more and more the norm in those areas. Because the fact of the matter is that it represents a much larger demographic of people who, by and large, do not have the time to dedicate as much time and effort to do a certain gaming task inside whatever game you're playing relative to the sort of traditional orthodox gaming population. And that and clearly there are certain business models that are going to work better than others in that respect in order to capture that that revenue. And I think that while some of us that are more diehard gamers may scoff at that, there's certain realities along with that. And I think to your point of these casual gamers don't want to spend, they either can't or they don't want to spend 8 hours a week doing this. They'd rather just have it. And they're willing to spend $1 or $2 or whatever it may be to get it done. And that is satisfying a demand, to say the least.
Sure.
Well, do we have time for one more topic, or are we about out of time?
We could do one more short topic, I think, if you want.
One more.
I would, one thing I want to talk about, and this sort of is related to the whole casual gaming stuff, is it's sort of the acceleration of technology. Traditionally, with these games, we've seen the PC market historically has been sort of the big mover of technology. It's been the PC market that has kept on increasing the cycle times of the graphics card industry and the CPU industry and things like that. And that's because the PC market as a size has enough volume to it, has enough people spending money that it can justify all those R&D dollars to be taken from the earnings that they make from selling you products and then reinvested for the next generation technology. And we've sort of seen a slowdown. And we've seen a slowdown because as the consoles have become more popular and represent a much larger player base, that technology and R&D monies has been bottlenecked. And so that larger amount of money gets allocated to the limitations that console market can and can't do. And so as successive generations of consoles come out, it's going to take longer for a lot of this technology to flourish. And we may not necessarily see that as much on the hardware perspective, because the PC market still exists and it's still coming out with new iterations of graphics cards. But it bottlenecks it on the software end. When game production companies and companies that make 3D engines realize that most of their demand is on the software end in terms of consoles, because there's going to be more software sales on consoles than on PC, it stymies that technology improvement.
That's a good point.
And because what they're not able to best utilize newest generations of DirectX, for instance. They're not able to utilize all of the additional memory available on our computers or in the graphics cards because they have to dumb it down to the limitations of what those consoles provide. Now, as new generation consoles come out, everyone will quickly get back up to speed to utilize those instances again, but it creates that bottleneck. And I have a fear that as the casual game market becomes more accessible and more popular, we may see a similar trend in the casual game market. We see CPU companies already looking to see how they can get into the ARM market, ARM CPUs, which are CPUs that are in cell phones. They're going to sell more ARM CPUs 2 or 3 years from now than they're going to sell regular CPUs you see in PCs or on consoles because there is such a huge demand for mobile-based computing. What does that do to the focus of R&D funds from these gaming companies, from the hardware companies and things like that as it relates to gaming technology? Does all that money now sort of get focused upon the mobile market? And does that create less of a incentive to put a dollar into the next generation Unreal Engine than it is to the next generation Unreal Mobile Engine that only focuses on the limitations of what those smaller, more energy efficient but less powerful ARM processors do? To me, this is more of a question, and I may be off base in positing it, but I think there may be we may too see a shift in terms of what the focus will be in terms of R&D investments for both gaming software companies as well as the hardware companies. What do you guys think?
Well, there's certainly a small select number of publishers and games that tend to drive the PC hardware market forward and the innovation there. And Battlefield 3 with the Frostbite engine in general was a real good example of that. And you're right, it's a point I hadn't really considered. I was talking to somebody and we were talking about next generation consoles, and I was saying there's relatively little reason for Microsoft and Sony to work faster on coming out with a new console, because we all know they never make money on the hardware in the beginning. Mm-hmm. They make all their money on games, and the longer they have it running. So really, the longer they keep systems like the Xbox 360 and the PS3 around, the better it is for their bottom line. As soon as they come out with a new one again, they're going to take a loss again for a while until that builds up. So when you don't have that driver pushing you towards better hardware, and this always happens on PC, then you could almost get publishers getting into that mindset of, you know what, we don't need to build a Frostbite 3 engine. We'll just keep building games for the Xbox 720 or whatever, churning them out year after year. People are buying $59.99 for them, paying for them, and hey, it makes our bottom line look good. If, as you mentioned earlier, they can figure out how to take out the brick-and-mortar stores and just deliver straight onto those consoles, that's the best of both worlds for them, then.
Yes, it is. Now, there's another flip side to this argument, which you could say, well, because the ARM market and the mobile market is getting so much larger than the traditional computing market, we actually may see accelerated turnaround times for that type of technology, to the point where you may find that its computing power may actually begin to get close to what we see with traditional PC-based computing. And they're actually two different – I'm generalizing here because they're actually quite different in terms of architecture, in terms of what they're good and not good at in terms of doing. But the point is that you may get to a point where there's enough iterization of that given market that it can produce technology that is a whole lot better than what we have otherwise. And let me give you an example of that. If you look at how – military computing evolved from the 1960s to the 1980s. It was really at a snail's pace, but it was always probably 75 to 100% more powerful than whatever was available in the commercial off-the-shelf market. And that basically stayed the same all the way up until the 1980s. And then when the personal computer and semiconductor technology exploded in terms of its potential, the commercial computing market went over the military computing market by leaps and bounds. And so nowadays, when the military wants some microprocessors, they're sourcing commercial. They're going to at least defense contractors that are buying commercial off the shelf computer hardware, because there's no way that the defense industry, or the military for that matter, can sustain the R&D funds needed to create this kind of technology and keep it up with what is commercially available. And so there may be some, and really this was not because the military suddenly became stupid. It was because that the demand for commercial semiconductors became so gigantic that the total amount of R&D that these companies had available to spend on successive iterations of semiconductors was two or three orders of magnitude larger than what the defense industry was spending, or the military was spending. So that's something to consider as well when thinking about this, is that even though that there may be some near-term issues with maybe the casual market taking over, if they get so big that they are 100 times bigger than the PC market, then maybe of the R&D money they spend, it may eventually create something that's a whole lot more powerful than what we currently are experiencing.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's going to be really interesting over the next few years. That's for sure. I mean, if you look back on how things have changed over the last, even just the last 10 years, it's been pretty major changes, and it's only going to continue to happen faster and with larger changes for the most part. So I think it's going to be really interesting. But when do you think the next generation consoles are going to come out?
My guess is late 2013, early 2014. I'm going to guess that Xbox 720 will probably come out in the a year from now, just in time for the Christmas season. That's my guess, but I'm not a gaming industry expert. I have nothing to base this off of other than just reading a few financial statements. When EA says we are investing for fourth generation consoles, that usually means they're going to be coming within, I'm guessing they're going to come within the next 18 months. That's my gut check to it. But we'll see. I probably am wrong.
Well, we'll see how it goes, and I'm sure we'll talk again before then, so we can always keep changing that goal, that prediction. Did I say holiday 2000? No, I mean middle 2014, or, yeah. I think that's probably going to do it then for this week's episode. I don't know what the plan is for next episode yet. Tim, I think we still need to get Mr. Roly the Poly back on the show. What do you think?
Yeah, I'd love to have Roland back on the show. He was a lot of fun to talk to. And from what I've seen in his Twitter and what I've, small conversations I've had with him, he seems back at work again for some more video goodness. So it'd be fun to have him back on and chit-chat about it for a little bit.
I want to see if we can get him on the show towards the end of November and see how his stash has come along.
Ah, that's right. Yeah, he is growing his mustache.
Him and Attic are making up Team Sweden for MOHHQ.com there. So
yeah,
it should be interesting. I want to remind you can find us at BattlefieldPodcast.com. We're on Twitter. You've probably seen various Twitter handles in the lower thirds, but also at BF Podcast. And on Facebook, BattlefieldPodcast.com. So you can follow, like, subscribe on YouTube.com/BattlefieldPodcast. All those places over there. And of course, I want to thank you again, Daskro, for coming on and giving us some of the insights into the business behind Battlefield.
Thank you all. Thank you, Tim. It's always a lot of fun.
All right. And thanks to everybody who is watching live in the chat. You can find us on iTunes as well, and we'll have the show posted in a couple days or so. And we'll talk to you then. Have a good one.
See you later. Bye.